guest speaker tonight, Nilima Chitgopekar from New Delhi, from Delhi University. She's an old friend of mine. We go back 20 years or so. And so she is a professor of Indian history and art at Jesus and Mary College, Delhi University. And I noted on her CV that she's been chair of the department no fewer than three times. She is a well-published author. This is not her first book, an edited volume, and I'll pass it around, Invoking Goddesses, Gender, Politics, and Indian Religion, a very fine collection of essays, and a very popular little book, The Book of Durga. So one of the things you will hear tonight is that Nilima is expert on the archaeology, the history, the art, but also on the living realities in Hindu lives today. What do these things mean? So The Book of Durga is a very well-respected book. The first book was 1998, Encountering Shaivism, the Deity, the Milieu, and the Entourage. And the new book, which you'll be talking about tonight, The Reluctant Family Man. Remarkably, she is also a published poet. A number of her works have been published, and she has a postgraduate degree in Indian classical dance. Many people today may not be concerned with the ritual worship of Shaiva tradition, but they still believe there's something enigmatic and worthwhile in Shiva.
Shiva in the 21st century, I've been fascinated for many, many years now on this whole idea of applying the Darwinian principle, survival of the fittest, to the Hindu gods and goddesses. It was done many years ago by a particular historian of religion. And she said all of them just don't survive. There's so many of them, but they just haven't survived to the 20th century when she was writing her book. And I found that even though you say many have not survived, the question that's bandied around a lot is like, how many gods and goddesses are there in the Hindu pantheon? And the number is 330 million gods and goddesses. Of course, a very apocryphal number. We don't think that there are 330 million. There are many, but 330. I mean, then where is the survival of the fittest? Where, what's happened to it? But what one can say is that when we look at the oldest scripture, when we look at the oldest text that we have, which is the Big Veda, there were many gods there. And today, in the 20th, 21st, and I would say right from 7th, 8th century onwards, there were three main gods and goddesses who became hegemonic, who had a very, very strong position. And that was Vishnu, Shiva, and let's just use the generic word, Devi, for the gods. These three, in their various manifestations, became the most important three gods. So 330 million, yes, there may be, but all of them sort of like, at some point or the other, are manifestations or representations of the three, Shiva, Vishnu, or the Devi. When we look for Shiva in the Rig Veda, interestingly enough, he is not even called Shiva. Shiva, the adjective Shiva, means auspiciousness, means benign, and he is actually called Rudra. And Rudra, it means the tempest, the god of tempest, storms, the roaring sound of the storms and the wind. And he basically, when you look at the hymns, you find that the hymns are addressed to him, or whenever you have a casual remark about him, it is basically to inspire a lot of fear in people. There's a lot of fear. It's not even awe. It's fear. Everyone is scared of him. And there's this whole drama being made about his arrows and the way he, attacks people and attacks mothers and children and cattle and everyone. And there just doesn't seem any reason for this immense rage that he seems to have. And even when I'm talking about the hymns, there are a total of 1,028 hymns in the Rig Veda. And what the philologists have done, and historians have followed that practice, they've seen how many hymns are addressed to which deity. Like, that's how we're going to see the popularity of a deity. So the maximum hymns are addressed to a god called Indra, or a god called Agni. But Rudra, who later on segues and becomes Shiva, has just about four entire hymns dedicated to him, and only 75 casual references to him. So what many historians have said over the years is that he's very hazy, he's just a minor god. But when I kept reading those hymns again and again before I was coming here, I found his presence is so strong, he's far from hazy. And I found that he is a god who is representing fear and the whole drama of fear. It's like celebrating fear. It's like celebrating something that is almost ugly, because when they talk about him, they say he's brown and he's got a black belly and he's scary to look at. People fetching waters have gone and have seen him hiding behind mountains. He's like a marginalized deity. And yet, he's got this, there's this aura around him that is getting sort of like created around Rudra. And we find that at the edge of it, you look at that, you're coming down to, let's say, around 600 BC. And you look at the Shatarudra there itself, again, he's still popular. His name, Shiva, is coming up. He's being addressed with a very famous mantra, Om Namah Shivaya. First time is mentioned there. So he's being called Shiva. From an adjective which was used for many different deities, it's now being used for him. He's still being called Rudra Shiva, so he's getting hyphenated. And some historians, and we feel it's like oxymoronic if you're going to say, okay, Rudra, then roaring, terrible, and then benign, Shiva. Okay, so he's together. You can see him getting created. Because what I'm trying to say and what I'm trying to show is how have gods survived? How have they changed? What changes have come about them that have made them popular with such huge people all over the country? Whether it's north, south, east, west, it doesn't matter. Shiva is popular all over the country. What has happened to him? And it's like barnacles have grown on, around him. You know, over the centuries, people have added so many characteristics and features which have made him profoundly attractive. The message that we get about Rudra is that he is an outsider. He is a marginalized deity, perhaps belonging to the autochthonous element, perhaps non-Aryan, not entirely sure, but just the way he's being addressed and the way he looks like a foreigner in a way, and the way he's always being castigated and always denigrated by the Brahmins, we can see he's an outsider. But such was his appeal that he was made to be brought into the Brahminical fold as one of their major divinities. And you wonder why, and that's why I say celebration of wrath, celebration of anger, celebration of all the anti-social, the mores, social mores, going against the social mores, the celebration of going against social mores. He's the one who represents all that. First time we're finding that he is worshipped as the greatest god and the only god. And so everybody, you know, it's like advertising Shiva, he's the greatest god. After that, there's a kind of silence. We don't hear that much about him. You see representation starting in sculpture. But then what happens is when we come towards Purans, and we know the Purans were written around 300, 400 CE onwards. Before that, of course, there were oral Vedic literature, so they must have been, you know, reciting much before that. We find that Shiva is now getting drafted, or things are being put with him that are going to make him more appealing. And for instance, the one thing that is put with him is that he's going to get married, he's going to have a spouse. And you can't see any of the spouse, any notion, any kind of trace of the spouse in the Rig Veda, any trace of her in any of the early literature. And in fact, one of the things that I wanted to mention is that in fact he's associated with asceticism. He is Mahayogi, and we'll be just having a look at it. He's this great ascetic. And asceticism is there even in the Rig Veda, because there are these strange people called Keshans. And Keshan has to do with long locks, Kesh's hair. Anyway, they're drinking and they're having these ecstatic kind of experiences. And that is something that we associate with Shiva even today, with the bhang and with, you know, with hash, with weed and whatever. Is he's associated with animals. So he's already associated, he's the one, he's Pashupati, he's also the one who destroys animals, but he's also the lord and protector of animals. He harkens back to a period when people were hunters and gatherers and moved around with their lances in their hand and destroyed animals and then wore the skirts for warmth and wore the clothes. And what we're going to see now is that in 21st century, some of these very important characteristics continue in Shiva. He doesn't get morphed completely the way Vishnu does. He doesn't need avatars to keep him, you know, solid and there in the minds of the people. He is what he is in the Rig Veda, and you see a lot of those characteristics continuing, except, you know, things I can say it right now, things like him becoming the god of dance, like Nataraj. No sign of him dancing in the Rig Veda. No sign of him dancing in the Yajurveda. But then he becomes Nataraj. But what is really interesting is he becomes a married man. And he gets a spouse as powerful as him, that is Parvati, Durga, Kali, whatever manifestation you want to call her. He gets a very powerful one, probably also belonging to the autochthonous element, someone who can match his skills and all the things that he does. He gets this wife. Now, what can be understood is that since he was coming into Brahmanism, he was being Aryanized, he was coming under the umbrella of being acceptable, then they probably wanted a god, the Brahmins probably wanted a god who represented asceticism, but they wanted to show that you can be an ascetic and you can be married at the same time. 6th century BC in India, a lot of people were renouncing the world. You were either a Pariprachak, you were a Shraman, you were a Bhikshu, you were whatever. You were leaving the world, you were renouncing. And what was happening to the Brahmins was they were not receiving their Dhan and Dakshina, their sacrificial fee, for all the various rituals that they were involved in. They were not receiving anything. So they did not approve of this kind of renunciation, of leaving the hearth, of leaving the household, of not getting married, of not having children. Because the moment you get married, you call the Brahmin, you give him a fee. The moment you have a child, you call the Brahmin, you give him a fee. But when you're going to renounce that and say, I'm not going to be a householder anymore, I'm going to be an ascetic, then they're not getting anything. They used Shiva as a representative. They used him that, see, Shiva is Mahayogi. Shiva is a yogi. He is an ascetic, but see, he's also happily married. So you can do both the things. You can marry and you can also be an ascetic. So it must have been a very cunning device. It appears to be that in hindsight, a cunning device by the Brahmins to keep a hold on people. That asceticism will be allowed, renunciation will be allowed, but within the parameters of a married life, and therefore you have to follow Brahminism. And if those of you who read the Purans, there are 36 of them, and most of them, they've been divided equally. They're sectarian. So some of them are Vaishnav, some of them are Shaivite, and some of them are belong to the goddess. Now, in all the Purans we find, the ones that I've been reading about Shiva, is that some sage is asking a question of the other. So who is this god Shiva? Why do we worship him through his palace? Why does he keep dancing around? Why does he wear animal skin? So it's like, now he's being accepted within the fold, and they're going to bring him in and show people that this is the reason, giving explanations through the verses of the Purans, giving explanations as to what kind of god is Shiva. So Shiva went on from one popularity to the other. If you read anthropologists, you read sociologists, you'll find that there are remote gods in Maharashtra, in Andhra Pradesh, in Gujarat, Khandoba, Mailhar, a whole lot of them, who were all fierce and angry gods in those particular regions, but all brought within the fold of Shiva and said, oh, this is just a Gujarat representation of Shiva. This is just a Karnataka representation of Shiva. This is just a Maharashtra representation. So they were all brought in. So there are also these elements of the local, the regional, the scriptural. Everything came within the fold to make this personality of Shiva. So when he comes and he gets married, what I find interesting is that it doesn't just stay at being married. There's a lot of tension between Shiva and Parvati. It's a very happy marriage, but it's also showing that there was cultic tension. That's one way I have tried to analyze it. Why are Shiva and Parvati squabbling? Why do they both have such huge egos? It's a cultic tension between the two of them. It's a sectarian rivalry. Because after all, the goddess Parvati, Durga, Kali, whatever name you want to give her, Sati, they had their own following. Shiva had his own following. And then they had to be brought together. And there are actual myths that show this extreme, rivalry between the two. But it's very important to be able to look at a deity like Shiva, who is so paradoxical that one of his epithets in English could be paradoxical. He's got so many contrary things in him, right? From being Mahayogi, the great ascetic, from being Natraj, from being, you know, Bhairav, of the scary one, from being Shiva, to being the married one. I mean, all across the spectrum, it seems like every mood, every thought that a human being could have, Shiva goes through it in his lifetime. And that's why it's easy for people, men and women, to be able to identify with him. And you wonder, why is he so popular when he hardly wears proper clothes? He doesn't have a very ritualistic thing around him like the way Vishnu does or Ram has or Krishna has. Why is he so popular? It's because he's that way. It's because he's got those wounds and emotions that we all have that we can identify with. And that's the reason why young girls will fast for, let's say, 16 Mondays, every single Monday they fast, and you'll say, why are you fasting on a Monday? And they'll say, because we want a husband like Shiva. And then you wonder, oh, he's so outlandish. Oh, he hardly wears any clothes. Oh, he goes around smoking hemp. Oh, he just disappears without telling her. But then you wonder, you know that people like more robustly colorful people, interesting people. Who wants that Sita Sara guy? Who wants that kind of person? So Shiva's popularity is just growing like you cannot even imagine, with the most wonderful TV series coming, which I watch and I'm amazed at how good the quality is, with wonderful books being written, novels being written about Shiva, and of course, like you're going to see just now, the kind of images that are still being built about Shiva. So I think that's time. I'll just show you. We can have some more. I'll just be discussing that.